every Monday we talk about 10 things that we learned from this past Sunday. The week is not over yet. Colts Ravens play tonight. But what did we learn from week 5 from Sunday's games? I'm going to go over 10 things that we learned. Number one, the Chiefs are in trouble. I think I talked about this last week, 2 weeks ago. I said, hey, Chiefs fans, don't worry. You'll be fine. And then after suffering that loss against the Buffalo Bills, I was like, well, if they can't compete with the best in the NFL, are they really one of the best? And I'm not questioning their ticket into the playoffs, the postseason. I don't know if that's going to happen or not. But I will say that their schedule this season, teams that they have to face, tough games that they have coming up, the Packers, Chargers again, Titans, Cowboys, Raiders. I mean, they face the Raiders twice, so if history tells us anything, the Raiders, they could split with the Raiders. Okay, so that's one loss right there. The Cowboys have been looking pretty good. As of right now, they've been looking better than the Kansas City Chiefs. That's another loss. The Titans, they could compete, so they could win against the Titans. They could beat, I don't know. It's kind of a toss-up. Like, the Titans, they've lost some heartbreaking losses to the Jets, so we're still trying to get a feel of them if they are one of the best in the NFL or not. But let's just say they beat the Titans. You got the Chargers. Say they lose to them again. You got the Packers. Say they lose. That's four games right there. That already puts you at a seven-game losing window right there. Seven losses. That means you got to be perfect in every other game. 10-7? Yeah, that could make it the postseason. But it doesn't say that you're one of the best in the NFL. So, I mean, I'm just looking at the schedule. Maybe the Chiefs are actually just in kind of a rut, and they're just going to turn it around. I mean, we all know about the talent that this offense has. I don't know. I mean, just from what I've seen, the Chiefs, they might be in trouble. Might be in trouble. Give the Browns offense, takeaway number two, give the Browns offense more respect. Yes, sir. Putting up 40-plus points and losing in that fashion. I mean, zero turnovers. I think that's a more of a bigger story than we need to be talking about. But I know a lot of crap was given in the way of the Browns offense about Baker Mayfield can't pass the ball down the field. Odell Beckham is washed up. Hey, who cares? Who cares if they're not a pass-heavy team? They run the ball down your throat. Nick Chubb had a great game. Kareem Hunt had a great game. This Browns offense is legit. And, I mean, I think that was the only thing that's kind of holding them back from being a top 10 team. But I think that after yesterday's performance, I would say they were a top 10 team, personally. Number three, the teams that face Kyler Murray moving forward should study film on the 49ers from yesterday. I mean, the 49ers defense, led by Kyle Shanahan and D'Amico Ryans, as well, former player of the Houston Texans, now defensive coordinator, the game plan that they thought of to try to keep Kyler Murray contained was perfect. And you could argue that if Jimmy Garoppolo was healthy in this game, if George Kittle was healthy, maybe they would have pulled off the upset against the Arizona Cardinals the way that defense looked. So I think moving forward, for any team that faces Kyler Murray and the Arizona Cardinals, you have to look at the film of the 49ers versus the Cardinals from week 5. Takeaway number 4, either Trevon Diggs or Matthew Judon should be defensive player of the year. 6 interceptions, could have been 7. I mean, he made an amazing effort to grab a ball that was going to be tossed out of bounds. Way more effort than Kenny Galladay because it went over his head. He didn't even try. Trevon Diggs got that. But it was out of bounds. So could have had 7. But now 6 interceptions on the year. And that's not a fluke. Because I know interceptions, you could be lucky sometimes. No, Trevon Diggs has done a great job of defending his receivers. And he should be defensive player of the year candidate. Along Matthew Judon, I think Trevon Diggs is the favorite. But Matthew Judon, 6.5 sacks so far through 5 games, has been looking great. Has been the best player on that Patriots, I would say, defensive line, if not the whole Patriots defense. Maybe even the whole Patriots team, Matthew Judon. Number 5, Ja'Marr Chase is for real. I know we were talking about, okay, for you guys, I own him in fantasy football. Me, I own him in 2 leagues. I was like, man, I don't know if this level of production can sustain. I mean, he's not getting the targets. He's only getting touchdown at... Now, the last 2 weeks, he's been getting targets against the Jaguars. He got 9 targets last Sunday. Yesterday, against the Packers, he had 10 targets. He's for real. He's legit, and he's only going to get better. Jamar Chase, takeaway number five, he's for real. Number six, Alexander Mattison needs to be a starting running back in the NFL. I don't know whether he's going to get traded before the trade deadline. I doubt it because I think the Minnesota Vikings love having him as a good insurance policy for Dalvin Cook. But eventually, maybe when his contract runs out, he's only 23 years old, and he's looking for a new team. Alexander Mattison should be a starting running back in the NFL. It should happen. There's been a lot of backup running backs in history that have done really well and then go on to be starting running backs for a team and have lots of success. I mean, the first person that comes to my mind is Michael Turner when he was on the Chargers, went over to the Falcons, had a lot of success. Alexander Mattison could be in the same line. Please come to the Falcons. Golly, we need you. Number seven, Jalen Hurts is clutch, but the coaching staff is holding him back. The game against the Cowboys, the game against the Panthers, when he had a terrible performance, and that could be on Jalen Hurts. I'm not saying that he's great in that aspect. But all I'm saying is that we've seen a lot of play calling by the Philadelphia Eagles so far this season. We often talk about the goal line stand against the Kansas City Chiefs, against the San Francisco 49ers, where they've had first down, second down, third down, fourth down. They go for it on fourth down, and they can't just get it in within 5 yards into the end zone. So I think the Eagles' play calling needs to turn around, but Jalen Hurts, the way that he's been playing, even though he performs poorly in the first half, in the second half, he has great outputs. So Jalen Hurts, takeaway number seven, is clutch. Takeaway number eight, Trevor Lawrence is getting better and better. It's only going to get better and better from here on out. Trevor Lawrence is going to be one of the best rookie quarterbacks in the NFL by season's end. And hey, for you guys that play fantasy football, towards the fantasy playoffs, he has a pretty soft schedule. I think he faced the Houston Texans and the New York Jets, if I'm not mistaken. Don't quote me on it. In like weeks 14, 15, 16, somewhere in that window. So Trevor Lawrence could lead you to a fantasy championship. Number nine, this is why Mike Tomlin is one of the best coaches in the NFL. His performance yesterday against the Denver Broncos, turning this Pittsburgh Steelers offense around. Maybe they're back in business. But Mike Tomlin should be the beneficiary or should be the one that's given credit for turning this Pittsburgh offense around. Mike Tomlin, one of the best coaches in the NFL. That's why he's one of the longest tenured coaches in the NFL currently alongside Bill Belichick and Sean Payton. And then lastly, don't get too excited about the Texans offense. I know they looked great against the Patriots, but I think this was more of a bad performance by the Patriots than a good performance by the Texans. I will give the Texans credit. Davis Mills looked great. But don't get too excited. One of the best offensive performances that they're probably going to have all season long. Hate to say that because I'm an optimistic guy, but it is what it is. And that is 10 takeaways from week 5.